John 13, John's Gospel. And I've been dealing with this subject matter, return to your first love, and I've been dealing with that for some time now in Revelations. And not going there today, but what I am going to talk about is that segregation in the church. And I met with some Pastor A.R, a good friend of mine. He had stage 4 cancer in 3 places in his body right now. And we met out Friday for lunch or breakfast or whatever. It was actually breakfast, it was early morning. And I met with a couple of white colleagues of ours, white pastor friends of mine. We was asking questions like, what's the separation in the church? And why is it so segregated? I just wanted to hear what they had to say. The answers that they gave weren't conducive to what I was looking for. But I know what it is, because it's the answers in this message I'm going to talk to us about on today. And so, not to say anything against them, because they're just doing the best that they can. Because I was wondering, I've been asking you guys to come to my church, and, our people, black folk, we're used to different nationalities, different creeds, colors of people, whatever, cultures, whatever. We're used to that here at St. Paul, because I built it up, I established that when I first got here, because I didn't want us to just think predominantly black. The reason why is because when we all get to heaven, it's not going to be black.
Amen.
I wish I had some friends. It's not going to be all black.
Amen.
It's not going to be the black community anymore. It's going to be a rainbow. It's going to be an assorted flavor.
Right.
I wish I had. I wish I had a few folk in here. So I asked these brothers, so when you come to my church, why don't you bring your church family? You come and show up, and you show up with your wife or a few of your kids. And, what is all that about? And so they said some answers. I ain't going to bore y'all with the stuff we talked about. But I said, okay, cool. I got you. But it made me think about this message today that I'm going to talk to you all about, because here Jesus in John chapter 13, verses 34, I'm going to use a few of these verses, but really 34 and 35 are key to this message. John chapter 13, and it was dealing with Peter's denial. Actually, the text was dealing with Peter's denial of who Jesus Christ really was. He said that he would even lay his life down for the Lord. And some of us say that stuff too until something really bad happens and it changes our mind. Rearrange stuff and readjust stuff, and we just don't really get it. But here, God showed us his great love through Jesus Christ, even when we deny him. He even showed us how we ought to love one another, because the fact of the matter is, the reason why the church is so segregated, that's my grandson, that's Sonny boy, Sonny again. The reason why the church is so segregated and one of the most segregated institutions on the planet, and it shouldn't be, is because the people of God aren't loving like they are.
I wish
I just had a few minutes of the time just to let you know that we're not as loving as we think we are. We say the words. I wish I had some help with that. And it's easy to say the words. You can say the words. I love you.
Oh, I love you.
But really,
really,
what shows up in your love is action. How many of y'all know that love is an action word? It is a verb and an adjective. It is used adjectively, and it is used verbally. It's a verb. It's an adjective. It means action. It's a punch word. When you do something, when you say that you love somebody, better than saying it, you want to be able to demonstrate it. See, the reason why God has us on the planet, one of the purposes that you all are here on today, is to find out and know that you're here to exhibit and display his love. If nothing else,
If you don't know your purpose, and you be like, you know, Pastor Woolard, I'm still seeking the Lord for my purpose. I don't really know why I'm here. Okay, I just told you. That's one of the things that you're here for.
That's right.
You are to put him on display.
My Lord.
I wish I had some praise about
here.
Because people have never seen Jesus.
Uh-huh.
They only see Jesus through you.
That's
right. Wait for amen to die. They never seen God in person. They only see God through you.
That's right.
And so you can't see the Holy Spirit, but guess what? He resides inside of you. And so you're supposed to put him on display. You're supposed to display the fruit of the Spirit, love. That's the very first thing. That's the very first point he makes is giving you fruit to produce is to love, to have joy, to have peace. It goes on, it goes on. But anyway, so I want to talk about this message on today from John 13, how we ought to love one another. Because before we can start saying we love others, and this even goes into marital relationships, parental relationships, all that, relationships with people on your jobs. You know, the folk get on your nerves.
Yeah.
Y'all just say it.
Yeah.
I know sometimes we don't want to say it, but sometimes you need to let folk know, look, you get on my nerves, and I'm saying that in love.
Yeah.
I wait for the amen to that. I'm saying it to you because I love you, and I don't want to be hypocritical or fake. I'm just letting you know, sometimes you need to shut up. You talk too much.
Too much.
No, you're mad at me right now, so I'm going to get silent.
Well,
maybe I said too much. But I'm saying it because I love you. You know, as a pastor, if I didn't tell you the truth, guess what? If I was up here preaching about God wants you to be healthy and God wants you to be well and God wants you to have $1 million in the bank and he wants you to be a millionaire. Well, I just lied to you. I don't love you.
Amen.
Okay, that went right over y'all head. Y'all looking at me like, oh, I do want to be a millionaire. But if I'm not telling you the truth, because that's not the truth. Because if God wanted you to be a millionaire, you would be a
millionaire.
All right, I'm just some hard work, sacrifice, getting your education, having a dream, having goals, you can do it.
Can do it.
But still, God had that plan for you all the time. I have a plan for you, Jeremiah 29:11. I have a plan. I have a plan for you. I wish y'all hear that. He says, I have a plan for you. So whatever your plan was, if it's not his, then it ain't going to really work. I wait for that. It'll work for a little while. It might be successful for a little while. And then you still find yourself empty and searching and still doing other stuff just to try to satisfy and meet those needs. Okay, so we have this problem. And it's in the church. It's in the church. And Peter was our example. And so, because, you know, I don't guess he thought Jesus was going to love him anymore after he denied him. But how many of y'all know we all deny him? We might not do it intentionally.
Right.
I don't think Peter knew he was going to do it intentionally because he already told the Lord he's going to lay it. I'll die for you. I'll go with you to the end and I'll die for you. And then all of a sudden, Jesus said, but let me tell you how it's going to be played out. This is how it's going to work. Yeah, before the rooster crow, three times. You're going to deny me. That's what he said. He picked them up, helped them out, and Peter became one of the pillars of the church. How many of y'all know that he was the pillar of the Jerusalem church? Peter, God refined him through those intentions and those deeds that he put forth. And he does the same thing with all of us in here now. When we deny him, and that could be throughout any kind of measure, because we deny him in many ways. We deny him when we don't trust him. We deny him when we don't depend on him. We deny him when we don't love on him. And you'd be thinking like, well, Pastor, how can I love on God if I've never seen him? Well, the same way that he loves on you. He
teaches you these things, and he's teaching us these things. So let me go in here so I won't hold y'all, because I smell that chicken and a big piece of biscuit. I smell it in that. Let me go on these words and see if I can make sense of this, and just for a few minutes of your time, how we should love one another. That is the most powerful element that God has left on this planet for us as human creatures, the crown jewels. I want y'all to listen to this very carefully. You are the crown jewel of his creation. You are just not a part of his creation, but we were created in his image. That means we are the crown jewels of his creation. We are special to him. You know, not just like the ant and the roach and the snakes and the giraffe and the elder. They are part of creation, the trees and the rose bushes and the sun and the moon and the stars. Creation, those are part of it. We are the crown jewels of his creation because we were created in his image. And so he takes that very serious, and you should too. Let's start at verse 31 and John 13. Verse 31 says, when he was gone, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. So he gives this commandment. He says, a new commandment I give you, love one another. This is how people will know and will distinguish you from folk in the world. He says, this new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So we put his love on display. We exhibit his love. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. This is one of the things that is scary and dangerous in Christendom today, is that you can't tell the church from the world. I wait for me. You can't tell the difference, because the church is acting so much like the world. And one of the biggest items to me is not so much the administrative side of it, like, you know, where preachers are talking about money and having building big edifices and having all the nice amenities and pleasures or plush things in life, but just that you go into a place in these mega churches where it's about 20,000-30,000 people, and there's no love. There's no forgiveness. There is a coldness. There's no reconciliation. You can't get to the bishop. You can't talk to the preacher. You got to go through 50 folk. And if your stuff isn't that serious, you won't get an audience with the pastor. You won't get an audience with the bishop. And that's not love to me, even though that one man can't deal with 20,000-30,000 people. It's not the folk. But, you know, most people want to at least be able to touch their pastor. And it shows when you're in a smaller group, because you know, they're getting, you know, folk are getting it. The intimacy of a smaller group is more intense than talking to 10, 20,000 people. They might hear you say stuff, but how can you really put that on display? And so I want to talk to you about just for a moment that how we should be loving one another. Yeah, because that's what's, and the reason why the church, the world is missing and it's going all crazy and all the killing and stuff. Of course, it is prophesied. Of course, it is talked about here in the scriptures and everything. But one of the biggest ideals of what's happening in Christendom today is that folk are not showing love, they're not displaying. And if they are displaying, and I'm not talking about everybody now, don't get it twisted. I'm not talking about nobody in here in particular. I'm not talking about individual groups of people. What I'm talking about is Christendom in a whole. Because the church is a big sleeping giant right now.
Right.
They're not doing what God called us to do.
The Great Commission work is to go out. Uh-huh. And so when you go out outside of your comfort zone, that shows that you love not only God, but you love what God called you to do.
Right on.
I wish I had some praying people in here. It's automatic that I go out and make disciples of people. Why? It's because he spared my life and made me a disciple. And so it's automatic for me to go out and share the good news or the love of Christ with those who are lost and hurting and dying and on their way to a burning hell. It is my obligation and it's my duty. I have the freedom and the privilege to serve the Most High God, Sovereign King of the universe, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I am one of his royal priesthood. I am designed to serve. And it starts with a demonstration of how I love you more so than anything else. I can say all the good words y'all want to hear, but if I don't show you no love, Paul said to the Corinthians, it's like brass cymbals clang, you're making a whole bunch of noise. You ain't doing nothing. You're just making a lot of noise. And I ain't here to make no noise, y'all, because life is too short on this planet. We are limited. I don't know when he's going to call my name, but guess what? I'm going to enjoy every day, Nick, to the fullest. I'm going to enjoy my life. I'm going to have some fun. I'm going to do what I want to do. You know, not nothing bad and crazy, but I'm just going to enjoy it.
That's
how he called my name on the road. Because he spared for a reason. And one of those reasons is that we are to love one another. We are to love one another. We can't say that we love this person or that person, and yet you don't even love yourself.
Not
one of the biggest issues. One of the biggest issues in the church today is that folk lie to themselves.
Not
it's not so much that you lie to me. It's that you deceive yourself. Lying to yourself, and then what happens is it shows up. It shows up in the pudding. And yeah, I know if you love me or not. I know if you're real or not. I do. God has given me that discernment. And you know, that's why I do stuff by myself, Fish, because I do good by myself. Even though I'm not a man, an island to myself, and I'm always around people all the time, but I do good by myself. I do good. I have fun by myself. I do good by myself. You know why? Because I love myself. And I love the fact that God spared my life.
Because
if you live the kind of life I lived in the past and did the kind of stuff I did, you be loving on yourself. You be thankful that God spared you and let you be here to see another day. Now, I know I don't supposed to be here. So yes, I do love some of me. I ain't tripping. I ain't boasting. I ain't bragging. I ain't tripping.
That's right.
But in order for me to love you, I love myself.
That's right.
Love nobody that don't love yourself. It could be superficial. Well, let me see. Can I get into this? Let me see. Can I help y'all love one another? Because we are supposed to love one another. It says that new command is that we love one another, and that people can tell who we are. Jesus says that the mark of true Christianity is love within the fellowship of believers. That means just what we're doing right now. The commandment to love was not new. It's not new news. Jesus himself pointed out the two greatest commandments of the Old Testament. And it was the command to love God, Deuteronomy 6:5, and to love your neighbor, Leviticus 19 and 18.
Yeah.
It was already put out in the beginning. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your enemies. Now, Jesus took it further. Jesus took it a step further. Now, this is going to hit some of y'all. Jesus said you got to love your enemies, too.
That's right.
Jesus said love your enemies, no matter how despiteful they mistreat you or misuse you. You want to know why? Because you were once an enemy.
Look out, man.
I wish I had some praying people. You were once the enemy of God. Romans chapter 5, it says that he demonstrated his love. Yet while we were still sinners, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, after us. Yes, he did.
Yeah.
I don't know about y'all, but that's good news to me.
Yeah.
Since his only begotten after me.
Yeah.
In my mess.
Yes, right.
I was doing all that foolish stuff I was doing. And so I understand that and I love it. Mm. I love it. And so Jesus' command to love is new in two respects. First, the love within the disciples is different from the kind of love we demonstrate to all neighbors in need. Second, Jesus said that we are to love as I have loved you. He has given to us a new model for this kind of love. What is the model? It is what Jesus did just before he gave the new commandment. In John 13, the disciples had gathered for the Passover meal in the upper room. Jesus knew that later that night he would be betrayed and arrested. But John says that having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. John chapter 13, verse 1. Knowing that it would be their last time together before the cross, Jesus showed them how to love one another because he washed their feet. When you read the text in the beginning, when you go back into the beginning, it shows you how Jesus was the servant, not only to God, but to mankind. After mission and after ministry, he took off his tunic or his top and made like a towel around himself or whatever and got down on his knees, got a basin of water, and he washed their feet because he was showing them, this is how you are to love one another. He is God, came out of heaven, incarnate, virgin baby, on his knees, washing their feet, teaching them a lesson that all of us in here should learn on today, that we have to humble ourselves. Because he was teaching them not only how to love one another, but he was teaching them humility because he is God washing our feet.
That's right.
I wish I had some praying people. God still washing your feet.
Yeah.
I wish I had some praying people. God still washing your feet, y'all. He's still washing your feet. Jesus showed them how to love one another. In the ancient world, people got their feet dirty because they wore sandals on dirt, dusty roads, and former meals like the Passover lasted a long time, and the particular these people reclined to the floor on the ground or on a low table, and so that your neighbor's feet were not far from your head. It was a common courtesy to provide a servant who would wash the feet of the guest, because this was a practice that they had back in the first century. It was a menial job for the lowest of servants. The disciples had gathered with Jesus for the Last Supper, but there was no one to wash the feet. And so they had been arguing about which of them was going to be the greatest. So none of them wanted to do anything to demonstrate or diminish their status. No one was stooped to do foot washing, but Jesus did. He got up from the table, wrapped a towel around his waist, took a bowl, and washed the filthy feet of his selfish disciples. They were stunned and they were embarrassed because here is God himself. They knew who he was. He is the Messiah. They sitting around arguing and tripping, and this is why the church is in a funk today, is because we're sitting around having business meetings, tripping, talking about everything but what to do to exalt and glorify God. You know, here at this little church, you know, everything we do, I tell everybody here, I don't care what it is that you do, as long as you do it to the glory of God, you're in good standing.
That's right.
You know why? Because he's going to give it success. He's going to make it work if you do it to glorify him. If you're doing anything to get a pat on your back or somebody to come and blow your head up and make you big headed, I've already been there, done that, and it ain't a good feeling when the Holy Spirit work on you. You're wrong. And so here, if you do anything, you do it to the glory of God, because he's going to bless it because you give him all the credit. I'll make that short. That's why we do what we do. Here the disciples are now embarrassed Because they sitting around arguing about who gonna be the greatest when we get to heaven. And tripping. And Jesus saying, no, here's the deal. You should be demonstrating love to one another. And you should be humble, because not only should you be serving one another, and it starts here first, but you, this is what you do when you go out in the world and demonstrate my love.
My love.
This is why the church is in such a funk, because we're not demonstrating the love of God.
Amen. Amen.
I'm not talking to anybody in particular in here. The church, Christendom, is not demonstrating the love of God. You got billions of people right now on their way to a burning hell because the church is playing instead of being. All right, that one went right over your head. I know it. I'm giving you the good news, though. Instead of us being the church and doing what he's called us to do, we're preoccupied with our prerogatives over our priorities. And this is why leadership in the church is so messed up, because, you know, prerogatives are things that you choose to do, but priorities is what God called you to do. First and foremost, seek ye the kingdom of heaven first, and all of my righteousness, and I'll add all things unto you. He should be your priority. Okay, all right, I know it. I ain't getting no help in here today, but that's all right. Because if y'all came in here to shout and fall out, and you weave and your wigs fall off your head and everything, you're in the wrong place. You're in the wrong place? Sometimes you got to teach the word of God. And so, because he's called us to demonstrate his love, and people aren't seeing it, and that's why they're moving into religions, and that's why they're doing other stuff. They're preoccupied, and that's why they're confused. And don't you see the world confused? Every time you turn on the news, and you see 7 shootings this weekend.
That's right.
Yeah. In the 757
race. Right. Yeah.
They called it violent. They said this has been a violent weekend.
Right.
Folks are confused.
Yes, sir.
No. Know why? Because they don't feel love.
I love.
People feel neglected and rejected, and they don't feel loved. And so guess what? They resort to doing stuff. The next thing they flesh tell them to do, that's what they do. Because it's not love. Let me move on, because I'm almost finished, y'all. I just got to make this point. We got to love one another. And he taught us how to do it.
Yes, he did.
He taught us that we should humble ourselves. And that we should serve one another. And that, you know why we do peacetime? Because at least that gives you time to at least get up and say good morning to somebody. Shake somebody's hand. Some of y'all come to church, your face looks so hard. You be sitting there looking like a nice little sheriff. I'm looking at you like, Lord, what in the world? How? You know, peace time gets you to relax. Go around and say good morning to somebody. Say how you doing. Might be the only time you get some peace all day. Is that peace time? You know what I mean? I got better get it down. When I go home, I might not have no peace. But this is where you demonstrate the love. You demonstrate it here first, then you take it in the world. And it should be easy for you, just like breathing. It should be easy for you to demonstrate it in the world, even though people are bad. Guess what? Everybody ain't bad. And so, you know, one of the things that get me talking with the church is that folk are afraid of people. You know, some people won't come to this church because they claim it's a disclaimer, too. That's a bad neighborhood. Hope we get shot and killed over in Barrage Park. No, they don't. They get shot and killed over in Huntsville. We have not had anybody shot and killed out here in 6, 7, or 8 years. I remember that day because I was in the park, and as soon as I heard the gunfire, guess what? I told the boys I was talking to, say it! That's what it means. I ain't waiting around to see where it's coming from. That's right. We're not here to say it. I hear the noise. You know, some folk want to just be nosy, and they want to look and see. Well, you be the very one I'll be watching on Wavy Tinky Tin, and not the right news, because you should have left, just like I did. Okay, I'm just saying, y'all, but we, you know, but no, people were getting killed over in Huntsville last year, but not over here in Barrage Park. You know, God has blessed this place, and so folk won't come to this church because they say, you know, y'all, you in a bad neighborhood.
That's right.
Yeah, I've had people tell me that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Y'all in a bad neighborhood. Didn't they ask you this?
offerings.
How many offerings do you take up? That's the next thing to ask. After they say you're in a bad neighborhood, how many times y'all pass a plate rack? I say one. On every third Sunday, you might take up one, but I miss that all the time, so we don't never get that. I'm just saying. Okay, y'all, let me get back to this. I'm almost finished, y'all, for real. So Jesus did this. He washed their feet, and it was a demonstration of his lowliness and the humility of his love that stooped down to even rescue us and meet our needs. Yeah, that's what it was. It was a wonderful gesture, but it did not come close to the demonstration of the lowliness that came when the one who was equal with God went all the way to the cross to bear the wrath of God for our sins. Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, that when Christ humbled himself to become one of us, he did not come halfway down and appear to us as a king. When Christ came down from heaven's glory, he came down all the way. He came all the way down. He made himself of no reputation. He humbled himself and became a servant. He went all the way down to the lowest point of humanity or human experience, a shameful death on the cross. And that's how he showed us how much he loved us. So when he said his new commandment was to love one another the way he loved us, that's what he meant. The model for love is humbling ourselves to do the most menial task to meet another person's needs. Even beyond that, the model for love is sacrificing ourselves for one another, giving up our lives for one another. And if you live like this, Jesus says, the world would know that you are following me.
My Lord.
He said, this is how you demonstrate love. You sacrifice, you give, you know, you take time with people. You know, some of the people that you think are the baddest people on the planet are some of the most needy people and broken people. And all of us in here, before we got saved, we had to come to a place of where we was broken. In order for God to even come inside of us and live inside of us and start to grow us and start to help us to understand even who we were.
Yeah.
You don't know your identity until you come to know the Lord as your Lord and Savior.
That's right.
You know, because we think we this and we think we that and a bowl of chips and we, you know, because we've accomplished this and we've achieved that and we think we all of this and that until we come to know him and the pardon of our sins. When I brag and boast about stuff like I love myself, that's because before Christ, I didn't know what I was doing. I'm stupid. I was doing some foolish stuff. But he looked down on me, and he saw a purpose in me.